Beautiful people, best damn nation. It is Wednesday, and you know what time it is. It is the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. I am your humble host, Brian Renegade, and with me, I have the best damn crew. First of all, this man can either save your life or beat you up in front of your girlfriend. He is the green-eyed bandit. We know him as the kick-ass specialist. He's your mama's favorite wrestler, and he can whoop your daddy ass, Mr. Everything, Victor Andrews.
What up? Oh, man. What up? I'm in the gym right now preparing to... Let it breathe. Preparing to kick somebody's daddy's ass. What's going on, y'all? What up, B? How you feeling?
Oh, man, what's happening, my brother? Let me get my camera focused. There we go. Well, what's happening? Nothing, man. I'm good. Just chilling. You know what I'm saying? Blessed and highly favored. You know what I'm saying? As the old folks will say. It's a beautiful day in Zamunda. Best damn nation. How are you feeling today? Let us know in the comment box. You say, hey, Renegade, I'm feeling pretty good. Oh, Renegade, I just need a word of encouragement today. And we got you. You know what I'm saying? The personal, what do you call it? Philosopher of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast? That's what I would be. You know what I'm saying? That's what I would be. What's happening with you, man? What's on your plate?
Man, I got a lot of food on my plate right now. I mean, you know the motto goes, don't sit at the table if you want to finish the plate. We clanging and banging and making it work. The workout I got me and AC doing right now, when I started putting everything together, AC was like, oh, okay. Now he's looking at me like,
how do I do this? You got AC Divine in there doing them insane-ass workouts. Run, AC. No, run!
He can't hear you. He can't hear you, so that way you can't hear me. So good.
Oh, man. Well, that's good. I hear the clanging and banging in the background, man. It's all good. It's all good. I need to ask AC. You need to ask him, is he ready for this tournament, man?
And that's why he in the gym right now, to get ready for the tournament. You ready for the tournament?
Hell yeah.
He said, hell yeah.
I heard him. He said, hell yeah. If I was a betting man, and I'm not because, you know, I'm not. If I was a betting man, I'll put some money on AC to take this tournament, man. He got some stiff competition, man. So yeah, you might need a couple of these workouts, Jack.
Well, absolutely, and this tournament's gonna be good, man. I secured the venue. We changed the venue a little bit. It's a little bit more. Where we were going in the first place was pretty good, but where we're going now, it's more aesthetically fit for what we need. Looks like a studio type thing. Old school NWA type of thing, so it's gonna be good. It's gonna be dope. It's gonna be nice.
I'm with the shits. I'm with it.
Best damn nation, y'all. Let us know who you're excited about seeing. We're gonna post the names of the guys that's gonna be in the tournament in the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast group page, and we want you guys to go up there. Matter of fact, let's do a poll. Whenever we get a chance, we're gonna do a poll and see who you guys think is gonna win the tournament, go through the whole thing, and and pretty much go from there, man. We want interaction from the Best Damn Nation. You guys, you love us. Right. We know it. We know you love us. You got to interact with us. We don't bite unless we have to. A lot of times we don't have to unless it's some food on our plate.
Well, Mr. Everything do bite. I have to make that disclaimer.
You can't be telling everybody.
I don't know what it is about Brownsville, you know, that just y'all just bite people. You know what I'm saying? Just if you don't bite yourself, you got a dog that bites somebody.
Well, you know, and shit hit the fan. You know, you're either gonna wipe it up or you're gonna wash it down. I don't know where I was going with that, but you know.
Ew, gross. First of all, sir, gross.
Let that fester.
I was wondering in which direction you were going with that,
I don't know where I was going. Let that marinate. Let that marinate.
Nah, don't let that marinate.
Yeah, we got a lot to talk about, man. We got a lot of wrestling to catch up on. We got the PLE coming up this Saturday, the King and Queen.
King and Queen of the Ring.
Tournament is going to be finalized this Saturday. We got Cody versus Logan Paul. Or is it Jake Paul? Which one is it? I can't know. One of the Paul brothers. Both of them getting their ass kicked. Both of them getting their ass kicked this weekend. That's terrible. How both of y'all getting your ass kicked this weekend? So we got a lot to talk about, but I'm going to let you go ahead and get started. I'm going to get this client moving on the next little exercise real quick.
Well, yeah, man, you just talked about it. The King of the Ring is going to be one for the books, man. And I'm excited to see what happens with the King of the Ring tournament, but I'm not quite sure if I'm really excited about the card itself. You know what I'm saying? And one of the biggest matches you just alluded to was Cody Rhodes versus Logan Paul. You almost mixed me up because I was about to call him Jake. But yeah, against Logan Paul, man. I think that match is going to be a good match. Am I excited to see it? No. I think it's a little early. I think it's somebody else that could have really took that spot and they could have built up to that. You know what I'm saying? So will Logan Paul and Cody Rhodes put on the show? Absolutely. They have to put on the show.
That's something that we spoke about before. Okay, once Cody wins the belt, who actually is going to be his, contend against him? Who's going to chase him? We don't really have anybody that's in a spot where they can be the antagonist for Cody Rhodes. We just had AJ Styles, and they just did one off, and that was it. You know, we really need somebody that's really going to give Cody a really good story and a little good chase. And I don't know why they chose Logan. And then they took his United States title off the line, too. So I think the last time we had a WWE United States champion was Seth Rollins. He was the last one that actually did it. Yeah. So I don't know.
I think it's going to be a good match, but I don't know if anybody really cares, if that makes sense. You know, I think it's too early, and I think that they should have built it out. And at least with AJ Styles, man, I don't know why AJ Styles isn't getting the shine that he desperately needs, man. AJ is a freaking engine in that ring, man. And AJ Styles is one of those wrestlers, almost like Ricochet. When he goes into the ring, you never quite know exactly what he's going to do, because he's going to pull out something new or something old that you haven't seen in a while and execute it so beautifully. And it just makes you enjoy an AJ Styles match. We saw in France, man, that the crowd absolutely loved AJ Styles. And whether they loved AJ or not, they were really singing the phenomenal song. And I'm surprised ain't nobody really made a song out of the French crowd chanting yet. It would be a great song, man. But just in general, I'm not sure. Let me ask the guru of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. He is the Boogeyman's best friend. This man is Mr. Evil himself. The villain of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. The Don of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. Ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you LP. He is in the building.
What's going on, man? What's going on,
fellas? Not much, man. We up here talking about this King and Queen of the Ring. And although I am excited about the tournament has been really good, man. We were sitting here talking about the Logan Paul and Cody Rhodes match. Are you excited about this match, LP?
Nah.
Okay. I kind of feel like that. I feel like it's no build up to it at all.
Yeah, the thing that they're messing up, in my personal opinion, with Cody, is what they do with most stars. The reason why Roman was such a big star wasn't because Roman got any better in the ring or whatever this other bullshit people say. they put that story behind Roman. So now Cody doesn't have to finish your storyline, which they push so hard. Now he got to come up with other stuff. And if they're going to just have generic people getting a title shot and losing and doing whatever, Cody's reign is going to be mediocre, just like Seth Rollins and anybody else. Like, my personal opinion, they're messing all the champions up because they're not giving them stories. And Cody and Logan Paul, is that a story? No, they just popped up. So it's not even a it's not even nothing you can get excited for. At least I can't get excited for. Because I don't see him losing the belt. If he loses the belt this quick, he better go ahead and retire.
Not retire.
No.
He need to give it up. If they made him lose the belt in his first pay-per-view match. Well, no, his second pay-per-view match. Yeah, he needed to go ahead and, you know, he finished the story. Now he can retire. But
all right, so we were all kind of advocating for Cody to finish his story. And I think that we were more upset that and part-timer came in and kind of stole the spotlight. But then he made the spotlight so bright and so good, you couldn't help but to enjoy it. And now that he is gone, and now that the former champion was gone, it feels like, I don't know, it feels like the air has been kind of taken out of the sails a little bit. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't, although I'm still tuning in, I'm not really as engaged as I used to be. Does that make any sense? Does anybody else feel the same way, or am I tripping?
I'm with you.
I'll be honest, I haven't even really been watching wrestling no more since WrestleMania, to be perfectly honest. I don't even halfway know what the hell's going on because I just felt like they were going to fumble the bag, and I feel like they fumbled the bag. I hate when people try to blame it on Cody. Y'all always know, I always thought Cody was boring, but I hate when people try to say they need Roman back because it's not no different. It's about the storyline.
I said it before. I miss Roman Reigns. I miss your tribal chief. I don't know what's going on with this new bloodline. We're going to talk about it. But Roman, there's a vacuum that Roman left. And although that vacuum can be filled with great superstars, man, I don't know. The storylines need to start popping up because the product can start... I don't know. Roman, it's starting to kind of stale a little bit.
What is it that miss about Roman when he was only on TV for once out of 3 months? So I mean, I don't miss Roman at all. Roman's biggest claim to fame is the fact that they put that humongous storyline behind Roman, and they need to do that with anybody else who they're trying to push or anybody else who. You know, they got to start building up. I think they got to start having one person at a time on that belt. That's the biggest mistake that they do. Like, when you go back and watch the old shows, Stone Cold, The Rock, Triple H, Undertaker, Kurt Angle, Jericho, even when they was off doing other stuff, they always still wanted the big belt. Like, they always kept that storyline going. Even though one or two of them might be going at it at a time, they always were hungry for that belt. Now, every person that fought Roman, they fought him one time and that was it. It's like, don't nobody else want the belt no damn more? So, like, that's another thing, too, that I think has become a problem with WWE is, like, KO fought him and almost beat him. He lost to some bullshit where everybody lost to bullshit with Roman. But he lost the bullshit and then he didn't want to try it again. So that's the kind of stuff that I think now that they're making mistakes. I don't know. That's why I think it's getting boring.
Yeah, I think that there needs to be better storylines, and I think there will be eventually. There will be. They're trying to build some storylines with the women. I could see, you know, Liv Morgan and Becky Lynch having a back and forth, and it's been pretty good, I guess. It's, you know, do I care about it? No, not really, but. They're trying to do more storylines with the women. And I think that if they do run that route, man, they can really find some gold there. And I think that Cody do need some really great dancing partners. But he the next phase of heels need to start coming out. You know what I'm saying? Like, to be honest with you, who are the heels on SmackDown that's really posing the threat to Cody Rhodes? Like, who are the heels?
Yeah, Cody, I think they're trying to make Cody a fighting champion. It's not good because
I don't want to see Cody as a fighting champion. I want to see Cody as a premier talent, and he is. Don't get me wrong, he is. But the storyline and the bad guys or the villains or the competition really need to step his game up. You know what I'm saying? And not to say, but it's not even the competition, man. It's the writing behind it and to make things interesting. Like, the storyline element that we fell in love with as far as the bloodline is concerned, although the bloodline storyline is still going on, it just feels like it's kind of starting to fizzle out a little bit. But the interest picked back up with Tama Tonga and Tomaloa. I butchered that, but
Beavis and Butthead. I said that. Beavis and
Butthead. Oh, man, don't do it to him. Tama Tonga is still in the. Well, let's talk about the bloodline real quick. Because they do have two new members who are brothers, and they are the sons of Haku. You know what I'm saying? So Tama Tonga and Tongaloa, Tongaloa was actually in WWE at one point. He was a tag team partner. I'm skipping my mind, but he was in WWE at one point. So it's good to see him back. And I'm interested to see how this bloodline storyline kind of folds out, because now Solo Sikoa is running things, and he's almost like a warlord. He feels like a warlord.
That's the Weeknd. He dressed like the Weeknd.
Yeah, he's like the evil version of the Weeknd. You know what I'm saying? What's the opposite of the Weeknd? The weekday. He's the weekday.
The weekday.
He's Monday morning. Yo, you know what I'm saying?
We need to post a side by side picture and put the Weeknd and the weekday and post that. Yo, nobody's done that yet. I think we're gonna be the first, and I think we're gonna be able to go viral with it. So let's go ahead and get that going.
Oh, 100%, man. This is gonna be great. But I think that Solo Sikoa is coming into his own. I think that he's starting to bring out different dynamics, and he's playing around with his character, and I really like that. I want to see how far he can push it and just not intimidate people, but really like make people fear who he is, because they don't know what he would do. You know what I'm saying? But I'm not sure if they need a softer element to the group, which Sami Zayn provided that when he joined the bloodline. A comic relief of some sort to make them interesting. You know what I'm saying? And not to say that they're not interesting, because I think they're going to really poise themselves as a really dominant faction where nobody is really going to want to cross them, how like the bloodlines of old have been. But I'm excited to see where the bloodline storyline goes, and we still don't know where Jacob Fatu is going to go. Mr. Everything, do you have any insight on that?
I don't have any insight as of right now. I'm waiting on some replies, but you know how it goes in professional wrestling. You know, guys get to a certain position and they're like, who are you again? Bro.
Yep, what did I was that? Oh man. But we shall see, man. I'm excited to see where it goes. And when Jacob Fatu does come in, I think he's gonna be a really dynamic piece to whichever side of the bloodline he decides to go. I think he will make a great face, man. I think that he can really get people to love who he is, and he can almost be like that Randy Orton character where he has a bad evil side and a good side, and you don't really care because he's Randy Orton. So he has the potential to do that. And there's been kind of swirlings going around the wrestling sphere, man, that the WWE is kind of worried that Jacob Fatu might outshine Solo Sikoa in the group.
Absolutely. He would definitely be the Umaga of the group. He looks like Umaga. He moves like Umaga. So, yeah, he's definitely going to do that unless WWE ties him down and puts some chains on. I mean, I think he would be Solo Sikoa's opposite. I don't think they could put him and Solo in the same team. You know what I mean? Because one's got to outshine the other. So just like, you know, the Rockers, Harlem Heat, you know, somebody's going to outshine the other. So I think Jacob coming in, he definitely has to be opposite of Solo, and that would make a really good dynamic in terms of a match of a one-on-one. Yeah, we still have Zilla. Zilla Fatu is somewhere out there, and just rumors of him going to WWE as well. So that just makes the bloodline even bigger. I mean, we might as well call it Bloodline Wrestling Entertainment. And at this point,
man, they're showing you how to take over the industry.
It's getting out of hand is what it is. Like, I'll be the one to say it if don't nobody else want to say it. I don't want to see 10,000 Samoans and wrestling.
Well, I keep telling you what to do, man. I keep telling you what to do. You got the predict that I'm going to get signed to WWE, and I can take it all that. Remember, listen to the intro. I'm the man that beats up daddy's asses. So go ahead and do your thing, man. Go ahead and rub the magic ball or whatever it is, or your six infinity stones and wish me to go ahead and get signed to WWE already, man. What are we waiting for?
You might not want to go to WWE right now. Not when The Rock bringing his whole entire family, and ain't nobody gonna be able to eat.
I'll kick the whole family ass. Hold up.
They gonna make you be you know, most of the black people that make Nigerian. They gonna say you Nigerian.
and I'll figure out how to do a really good Nigerian voice. Me and Apollo Crews would team up, and we'll get coffee, and we'll bring back his Jamaican accent, and we'll tell Xavier to figure out something. We'll just run a whole new nation of domination. That's what we're gonna do with Big E as our manager.
I just think that they doing too much because the bloodline is already on the borderline of the NWO. Like they are literally two steps from being the NWO when the NWO got old. Like, even if you bring back Roman and you start this bloodline war, which everybody assumes is going to happen, to me that don't even make sense to have Jay come back into the bloodline. Like, to me, they already beat the shit out of Jimmy and Jay ain't do shit. What's your damn twin brother? So why would Jay want to have anything? What can they do to get Jay in the mix? They gonna beat up his wife. That's the only other thing. Wait, which one married Naomi? Is it Jimmy or Jay?
Jimmy.
Oh well, hell, never mind. That one didn't work. They already done what Jimmy asked. So there ain't no reason. There ain't nothing to get Jay in the back in the bloodline. So like, it's gonna be interesting, but like, I don't know. I'm not really feeling it. Like, I don't think Solo. I wanted to see Solo flip, but I think the way they did it, I just don't like the way they did it. And him trying to look all like a boss and all that ain't you, Solo. Like, go back the way you like. He should be able to run it differently or something. I don't know. I'm not feeling the whole new bloodline. These new guys coming in, and they supposed to be making everybody afraid, and they getting all these wins over these stars. Like, dude, just beat LA Knight. They shitting on LA Knight so bad. Which one of them just beat LA Knight last week? It's like, come on, man. Y'all still supposed to be in the middle of pushing LA Knight. And now all of a sudden, if I was a wrestler, I'd be like, man, how the fuck these guys just showing up? But at the same time, I know who they are, I know who their family is, and I know who the boss is, who is The Rock. So what can you say? You can't say nothing if you still want to have a job.
I told, listen,
I don't know if y'all listened to me when I said this, but I told y'all it kind of feels like Vince McMahon kind of passed the torch and the company and everything over to The Rock. Like, it's almost like he handed him the baton and be like, okay, now it's time for your family to eat.
Nah, Vince will never get that to a man of color. I'm so sorry.
The proof is them, man, the pudding.
The Rock's
daughter, Ava, is the GM in NXT. The Rock is on the board of TKO. You know what I'm saying?
The only one that's missing in the equation is Tamina. Tamina ain't doing nothing.
You know, there's always that one cousin. It's always that one cousin. He just like, you again. I'm not gonna do
it. Oh, you still here? I forgot you was in here. What you was doing?
Yeah, Tamina might come back. You never know. You know what I'm saying? You know who I would be really excited to see in the WWE to start a female's bloodline faction? I would love for the Tonga Twins. Have you ever heard of the Tonga Twins?
Yeah, they just got released from... they didn't get released. They left. They left. Wow. So... Yeah,
that'd
be good.
I would love to see them.
Lady Tappa. Bring Lady Tappa back in there too.
Yeah. I would love to see the Tonga Twins and Nia Jax together as a female bloodline faction. Man, take my money. Take it off. I would love to see that. You know what I'm saying? Now, I know we had been talking about a female faction of the Samoan descent, or you know, even Black descent. I know we've been talking about different ethnicities and different factions. We see the Kabuki Warriors with Damage Control and what they're doing and representing for the Asian community, and we see. Bianca Belair, Jade Cargill as the women's tag team champions right now. That's great to see. Bailey, who I believe Bailey is of Mexican or Spanish descent, she's the women's champion right now. So I'm loving to see all this different diversity, man. And matter of fact, LP, you had we had the. I didn't post it because we had to backtrack the statement. And I didn't want us to post nothing that was wrong. But I think this is the place to really talk about it, man. But since we're talking about the women's division, there was some almost backlash or heat from the WWE Universe, man, over a post that Tiffany Stratton posted during her match with Bianca Belair and Jade Cargill. And in the post, she hit Jade Cargill in the mouth and knocked her off the ring ropes. And then it shot into Bianca's face. And then there was a voiceover that said, "You Black B word." You know what I'm saying? And so a lot of people felt some kind of way about it. And there started to be some backlash on that whole thing. So I want to give us the place to talk about it, because we've seen the clip, and we've seen how everybody is kind of latching on and telling their opinions about this whole Tiffany Stratton situation. Maybe she didn't view it that way. I don't know. We are a little bit older, so we all know this stuff has intent, deep underlying intent. But LP, I want to give you the space right now. Talk about the whole Tiffany Stratton thing. How you feel about the whole Tiffany Stratton situation? LPZ.
I said it on the video that you see us to go back and post. I'm gonna post it on my damn page. you know, if it would have been bitch. or whatever, that would have been fine. But the moment you designate a color, you designate an ethnicity, you designate something like that, you change the term. You change the, I mean, the term is already a derogatory term, but, you know, if you call it in the middle of, you know, a fight or whatever, that's one thing. But when you say black bitch, or it says black bitch, or you make sure black bitch goes up there, you know exactly what you're doing. I'm pretty sure she, her, and some of the other females are probably tired of seeing these black girls get this shine. So she might have just forgot where she was at, and she was probably saying herself, I'm sick of this black bitch. In the middle of the action, that's when it came out. It just remind me when Booker T was doing a promo and he forgot where the hell he was at. He thought he was in the streets, and he said, "Ho, ho, we coming for you too, nigga." And that's what Booker T normally would have said. But he, even when you watch that promo, the funniest part is not when he say the word; it's his reaction right afterwards. Like he know, like, "Oh God,
God." Him, and Sherry. Sherry went and grabbed him. Was like, "It's okay. It's all right."
Yeah,
it's all right.
But you know what, Tiffany Stratton didn't actually. But the thing is, Tiffany didn't say it. She used a sound bite from one of the apps, and that's where she got the whole lot of backlash. But even still, you know, angry minds kind of. Say they're real feelings. You know what I'm saying? So
you're a wrestler. You're a wrestler, Roosevelt. So you're in the match. I don't know how much trash you guys talk and y'all match or whatever, but I'm pretty sure if a guy talking junk to you in a promo or blah, 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 is there a line? Like if he's just like, I'm going to beat your ass, you little black nigga. And your son, I'm going to choke out your little black ass son. Like if you had a guy who went that far, Where is the line when it comes to wrestling? Only you can tell us that, because I don't know.
That's a good question.
There is a very, very thin line between getting your face broke and getting buried in up under the ground. And I've had somebody come at me kind of sideways, but didn't really say anything too deep. It was like getting to that point where I was like, all right, your next words that you say, you better be very careful in what you choose, what you say. And then he inboxed me and was like, hey, man, you know, just let's keep it going. You know, it's just a work. You know, when it's working, I'm like, okay. As long as you let me know that you're working and not trying to really, because if we go to the ring, I'm going to look at you like, now, what was all that you was speaking when you was on the social media? Because I don't talk heavy, I hit heavy. And you can already find out. But there is a line that a lot of guys don't cross. You know, we don't do racial, we don't do family too much, unless you have your family involved in some kind of way. And then there's a permission, a level of permission. Like, okay, if I said something about, you know, your wife sleeping with me, are you okay with that? You know, and you're like, nah, we're not doing all that. Like, that's not necessary. But then again, if you can't get over without attacking someone too personally, then you don't need to be in this business. You need to go back to training. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of guys, they use that personal stuff and try to get themselves over. But I'm like, if you can't get over without doing that, then you're doing it wrong. And you're doing it for all the wrong reasons. You know, yeah, they're going to look at it. But then at the same time, when we show up to the show, I understand that when I say it was on site in the promo, it's on site in real life. You know what I'm saying? So, and that's what the fans are going to expect. So don't expect me to go in there and lock up with you and you want to tell the story of I'm a better wrestler. No, I'm going to show you that I can fight at this point because you attacked my family. So you got to have an understanding that if you go personal, then the match needs to match that. The actual fight needs to match that type of energy. We can't go in there and be like, okay, we're going to shake hands after the fact. And that just looks stupid.
How would you handle that situation? So, And let's say you had somebody with a sound bite and it was like, you know, black nigga. So I'm gonna put you in the same situation that she's in. How do you move forward? Because do you say, like, of course you gotta finish the match or whatever, but like afterwards, like I really want to know what happened afterwards. After that,
so at the end of the day, business is business, right? You gotta conduct business. Go to the back and discuss it. You know, you don't want to, we never really want to take away from the fans that paid their ticket for what they came to see. You know, if you take it personal in the middle of the ring, not only can the rest of the locker room not trust you, but then the fans are going to be like, okay, where was this kind of energy last week? Or where is this kind of energy that you showed last week? You know, and that type of deal. So, if like I've seen guys get upset and they have your little issues during the match and it goes bad. And then the fans are like, okay, this is getting a little too out of hand. I don't want to bring my family. I don't want to bring my kids back to the show because these guys don't know how to get in here and compete. You know, yeah, it's real or it's predetermined at some and to some extent. But at the end of the day, I got my family here. I have my kids here. So if you guys can't conduct yourself like professionals, what makes you think I'm going to come spend my money here? So, you know, if it was me and somebody said that to me in the middle of a match, I'm going to finish the match. But when we get to the back, we're going to have a conversation because I want to see where your mindset is, because the next match that we have is going to be an MMA fight. I'm not having a wrestling match with you. I'm going to have a real fight with you. And it's going to be discussed to the fullest extent of why we're having this fight.
I can see that. Let me play LP's response and video to the old Tiffany Stratton thing. And we just got to explain to you what happened as far as the soundbite being played over. But let's just listen to LP's opinion on this whole thing.
All right. What's going on, everybody? It's your boy, the resident villain of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast, LP. So I want to talk to you guys for a minute. Just a quick second. Tiffany Stratton, you got some explaining to do. So everybody's talking about Tiffany Stratton, whether what she said was racist, what was just the heat of the moment, or whatever you want to call it. For those that don't know, in a match, Tiffany called her, she was wrestling a black bitch. She was wrestling a black female at the time when she said this in the middle and the heat of the moment. So basically you got two sides. People are saying that was very racist, and you got people that's going to try to justify everything no matter what anybody says. So let me tell you guys something. If you call somebody a bitch, if she just would have said bitch, it wouldn't have been no big deal. But when you designate that with a color, you black bitch, like if a racist is having an argument with a black female, she'll be like, you black bitch. She can even say you bitch, and it's not going to hit the same. The moment you put black bitch, it stands out a little bit more. I personally, do I think she's racist or whatever? I don't know her personally, so I can't sit here and say that she is or she isn't. Do I think she has issues with black women? Yes, and let me tell you why. Hear me out before you go in the comments trying to jump on me. Everybody remember the infamous Booker T promo when he was like, Hogan, we coming for you too, nigga. Booker T got so engulfed into that promo that he basically forgot where he was for a minute. And his real self came out. His Harlem or wherever, Texas or whatever it is. When Booker T talks to people on a regular basis, he drops the N-word. He probably still does to this day when he's talking to his friends, talking to Stevie Ray. Nigga this, nigga that. That's just, you know, how some of us talk. Booker T talks like that. And in that moment, his real side came out. There's actually been several occasions, but this has happened during a promo or in the heat of the moment. This wasn't something that was written. This was something that was going out in the middle of the match. And during that match, Tiffany Stratton, just whether she got issues with her or not, her true self jumped out for a minute, and it was, you black bitch. So that was very racist, and for anybody who want to justify it, again, the moment you say black, that's just like if she was a Hispanic, or she was like, you Puerto Rican bitch, or you Asian bitch. Like, the moment you throw certain things in, you change it up a little bit. You know, saying that calling somebody a bitch is a bitch, but once you change it up, you change it a little bit. So I personally feel like Tiffany Stratton probably does have some problems with with black people, with black women in general, because again, I didn't say it, she said it. You didn't say it, so you can't sit here and protect her, or you can't sit here and say, oh, she said that because of this, or she said that because of that. She know why she said it. Like, if have you ever been arguing with somebody and something came out in the heat, or you got excited about something, or you weren't supposed to tell a secret or something? Like, this is how your mind works. Sometimes you can be thinking about something, or it can just come up, or, you know, if you don't like somebody, you might drop a derogatory term, and that's exactly what happened. It ain't no cleaning it up. There ain't no saying this. The WWE is not going to do anything about it. If anything, it isn't going to take her push away, or she's not going to win the Queen of the Ring. It'll be something like that, because you guys are not going to make enough noise like you should. I mean, this is the same company where Vince McMahon said, "What up, my niggas?" and got nothing happened to him. Like, nobody even brings it up. But to now, I mean, even back then, I might have laughed, but that was a totally different situation. But at the same time, this is a company that we know how black people get treated, whatever. You know, I think Bianca, Jade, any other wrestlers of color, they really should have been in the office like, "Yo, what's up with this?" Or they should have came at her like, "Yo, what's up with that?" Like, certain stuff you can't let slide, because you have to, as a black person, you have to pay attention to the smallest things. The smallest thing, because people who are racist that are around black people or got to work with them, they're not going to act like they're racist. But every now and then, the truth comes out. A lot of you have supervisors. I've had supervisors that was racist, and eventually it always comes out. And we, as black people, we know how to sense it. White people, you would never understand it. You would be like, "Oh my God, yo guys, you guys are blowing it up. It's not such a big deal, blah, 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 blah." Black people know certain signs that come out, and this was one of those signs. So you guys can sugarcoat it and say all you want. What she said was very racist. Is she a complete racist? Like, again, I don't know the chick, but does she have issues with black people? Yeah. And it came out during this pay-per-view. Not pay-per-view. Is it pay-per-view? Whatever. It came out during this match. If you're not, watch the clip if you can find it. Because if she didn't have an issue, why would you delete it if it wasn't that serious? Because the boy said you need to delete that ASAP. But you know we won't find out about it. I mean, come on. But yeah, she definitely got some explaining to do. I don't know if she's made any kind of video or saying anything afterwards. At this point in time, like most people, you assume people are going to forget. I'm not a fan of her, so I mean, it doesn't matter to me anyway. But she's definitely got some problem with black people. It's your boy, the resident villain of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. Peace.
You stand on that?
Yeah, I stand on it. with both feet and toes in the ground. I just think things like that don't ever happen. Things like that don't happen by accident. Either you did it for heat, like Roosevelt said, you're trying to get some cheap heat, or the truth came out. Them the only two options that it could be. It was done on purpose for cheap heat, or you know, or it just came out. It ain't no accident. That definitely accident is not even nowhere close. It's only got two options.
Oh man, you made some good points there, man. And I think that if she watched the clip and then reposted it, she was very aware of what it said before, unless she had her phone all the way down and couldn't hear it. Just saw the action and posted it. But you're right, she heard it, then she consciously posted that. So I'm not sure if she just saw the video and was like, "Oh, that's me. That was a good clip. Let me share that." Or if she has beliefs in what was shown in the video as far as what was heard being said, the voiceover that was being said. So I don't know. Like you said, I think it's going to get swept under the rug. We're going to walk right past that, because there's going to be more stuff that happens. It's going to be stuff worse than that. So, you know what I'm saying? We'll see, man. We will see. Well, one of the things that NXT is really drawing attention around, man, is really being a place for young talent. And they have a very diverse roster. And right now, the NXT champion is Trick Willie, the one and only Trick Williams, man. I'm an absolute fan of Trick Williams, man. I love his back and forth banter. I don't even really need to do wrestle, man. I think he is absolute dynamite on the microphone. So I just hope that he keeps on developing and gets better. But there were some there was some offline social media buzz where Trick Williams was had posted something. Sexy Red actually made a comment on it. And Trick Williams was like, you know, come on down to NXT. So exactly that's what she's doing. Your girl Sexy Red is coming to the NXT brand, man. I think Shawn Michaels is cooking, man. He's listening to either some young people or, you know, they just know what to do, man, to be able to put eyes on the product, man. So the girl Sexy Red is coming down and bringing all that ratchetness down to NXT, man. I think they're going to turn up. I think that is good because a lot of the young stars here to interact with someone who's considered to be a superstar right now in the game. Fellas, how you guys feel about the girl Sexy Red coming down to NXT? Apparently, she is a wrestling fan, man. So I think that's great.
I didn't know who she was. I just asked AC who she was, and he just told me. What in the entire hell is going on? Who the hell let the gate open? Why? For what purpose? Why? We have two women of color that are representing the culture in a very, very great way, okay, and Bianca Belair and Jade Cargill. Sexy Red could be a really nice woman, but her music does not represent the culture very well for young black girls. The hell they bringing her in there for? For what? What is she really going to add to the product and to the brand of Trick Williams?
I can tell you that right now.
The whole thing with the lashes and let them know that you're pregnant thing, that was too black for me. That was so black, color purple, niggerish, Kunta Kinte type shit, boys in the hood, menace. Like, why? For what? Why did they have to play up Trick and lashes? Might be having a baby for what? Like, I thought we were doing with that.
Okay, so you're talking about the storyline between Trick Williams and Lash Legend, where Lash had an envelope and she was saying, "Hey, I got some news here that'll, you know, crumble your whole world or expose the truth." And they made it such so it was like, "Who's your daddy, Maury Povich?" kind of thing. That's been done before in the WWE, and it's been done before in wrestling, so I'm not surprised by it. But you ask what Sexy Red brings to the table, man. She brings eyeballs. You can see that on every media outlet. I just saw one from the Breakfast Club right before I logged on to the show that Sexy Red would be in NXT. You know what I'm saying? So,
Quick question. Quick question. Didn't we talk about this when AEW was doing it? When they kept bringing all these different rappers in there with no real purpose? Yeah, Rick Ross in there. You had, what's your boy? You know, you had a bunch of different rappers going in there just doing
fabulous.
Shit.
It was a lot of different
rappers. Yeah, and you just had them just doing nothing and really, like, just look at it. Look at AEW now. They had all these big stars in the rap game, and it ain't do shit for them. Like, WWE has had some artists of music and things like that. They had Lil Wayne, and then they had Wale, and what's the dude? Meek Mills. You know, okay. Sexy Red? Sexy Red, though?
I mean, Sexy Red got shade, but whether you listen to her music or not, Sexy Red got followers. And Sexy Red got people who love her music for some reason. I personally think that women that love Sexy Red music got roaches in their car. But, you know, that's just me.
The opinions and views of Brian Renegade only reflects Brian Renegade himself. Does not reflect the rest of the Best Damn Wrestling crew of the Best Damn Wrestling podcast.
Oh, man, I think they got roaches in their car and they got dirt rings around their showers. I'm just saying, You know what? There's a place for Sexy Red in music and hip hop. You know what I'm saying? That's just what it is. You know what I mean? So right now, you cannot deny that she is a chart-topping artist, man, and that she has fans, a legion of fans all over the world. And the fact that she is a wrestling fan, I think that kind of gives her some credibility because she knows what she's talking about, even though when she steps in that world, she's going to be a fan. I just hate people that don't know anything about wrestling, don't know anything about the product, and then come there and kind of make a mockery of it. So I just hope that she doesn't do that, that she can't add something. Maybe she can play some of her songs that the NXT women's roster can twerk. I don't know. You know what I'm saying? I don't know. They might do something like that. They've done stuff like that before, so what I'm saying is not out of bounds. They've done stuff like that before, so we don't know. We'll see. We will see.
It's not going to move any needles at all. Can we stop the madness? Can we stop the damn madness? The time when Sexy Red music was popping is coming to an end. Like, her stuff is not hitting like that no more, because that little fad, just like, you remember when they had mumble rap, and you don't have mumble rap anymore. So this whole Sexy Red, all these nasty females and all that stuff, that time is coming to an end. So she's trying to find some way to get some attention. That's all that is. And this
is coming to an end, though. I think that the whole industry is pushed towards promoting music such as hers. You know what I'm saying? That type of music, that type of narrative. So I don't think it's been perpetuated in a lot of artists in every song, even in WWE's music that we hear sometimes. You know what I'm saying? Related back to wrestling. But yeah, as long as there's people that's willing to listen to it, as long as there's stations just willing to play it to make money off of it, it will be popular. You know what I'm saying? Will it be and it's by choice. I mean, you have the ability to shut stuff off. Right now, you can. You have the ability to shut stuff off. So, you know, no matter what your preference is, I think that WWE finding different musical artists or entertainment acts to be able to bring more eyes to the product, I think that's definitely doing it. And for her to say she's a wrestling fan and all her fans like, girl, you still watch wrestling? She like, hell yeah, I still watch wrestling. Catch me on NXT on Tuesday. You know what I'm saying? You don't think that people gonna check in to see Sexy Red? You don't think that some Sexy Red come there, that all the media outlets are gonna push it up, put it up and push it out? She know that.
I agree with that standpoint, but then, like you said, I hope she really is a wrestling fan and not just trying to use this as a way to boost her own brand. You know what I'm saying? Because she don't look real stupid.
I lost my damn internet. Let me jump back on what I was damn saying. Ain't nobody. God dang Sexy. I'm saying something about on the Breakfast Club. That's it. That's Black Radio. Don't know, but she ain't dropped on her neck. Now she gonna get somebody to slam on some shit, then somebody will tune in. But I want you to put that picture back up. Put that picture of her back up.
She might hit a 619 on somebody. You never know. You know what I'm saying?
She was 619.
Who the hell trying to see that? look at that. Who in the hell tuning in? She ain't J Lo. She ain't nobody that somebody want to look. I don't even look at that. Just look at that. That's breaking down from top to bottom. Get out of here. Wrestler fans.
I told her like the Crypt Keeper.
Oh man, how y'all gonna get on me? Y'all up here dogging on it, bro.
Man, that girl. Good Lord. That's sexy. I don't know what, if that's what sexy is, I must be too old for the game.
It's sexy now, man. You know what I'm saying? People got all kinds of tattoos on their faces and all kinds of stuff.
Her time is up, but she's trying to get some clap. And she about to use dude to get some clap.
Yeah, that's she definitely
about to use. We got enough the women superstars to do the twerk. We don't need Sexy Red to go down and motivate them. We got the top three. We got the big three. They do it all the time. We don't need nobody else. For what?
Well, you know, you might see her on the main stage at some point, man, because, you know, WWE is the limelight. You have to think about it. Even from the first inception of WrestleMania, man, music has always been a huge part of what the WWE does to be able to get their stars over, man. So
I get it. But ain't nobody about to tune in to WrestleMania here. Ski!
I bet you they will. And listen, I guarantee you, if she go there and play Ski and all the NXT women's roster come out and start dancing, I guarantee you gonna watch that. Put money on it. Tell me you ain't gonna watch.
Last Legend, all she need to do is just walk, and I'm watching her. I don't need no music, bro. I'm gonna keep it on 100 with you. I don't need no music. She got a beat on her own. Her thing go doom 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 doom. That's all I need.
You must have forgotten what the wrestling demographic is. What's the main people that watch wrestling? And it ain't damn us. They're gonna be like, who the hell is that? Sexy what?
Sexy what?
What the hell is that?
I think she was on Fortnite. She was a Fortnite character.
Somebody
grabbed
the bug spray.
Yeah. Jay Cargill, they like Jay. Cause they ain't got no choice but to like Jay. Them there, you woo, that's a good color woman right there. I know me don't mess with a woman of color, but I damn sure can. I sure can mess with Jay.
Speaking of bug spray, let's take a moment to recognize some of our sponsors. One being was STD.com. Let's go ahead and
throw out to our sponsors real quick. Mr. Everything just mentioned one of them. If you have a burning sensation down below, if you got some bug on your back that you need to identify, you know what I'm saying? If your tongue ain't feeling just right after you went down south, then go to stdcheck.com to one of our sponsors. You can go on and look at symptoms. You can also get some advice and some help. You know what I'm saying? So at the discretion at your home. So go on over there. If you got something on your legs that you can't identify, if that pimple on your ass, just don't look right. It's a little pussy. Go to STDcheck.com. Oh, man. And listen, we're going to go ahead and kind of transition. We're going to do a throwback video of Mr. Everything in the ring, man. And just in case, this man has been on and off WWE TV for some time. And this is a throwback to one of his matches where we were so excited. And then there was a meme of him absolutely getting laid out of the ring.
Why do we have to do this all the time?
Well, you know, we just got to show some love to your past, sir. It's okay. It's a blast from the past. Mm-hmm. Embrace it. Matter of fact, I want you to navigate it, and I want you to do commentary on this match and what was going on, man. So we're going to give a throwback to Mr. Everything debut in Greensboro, North Carolina, against the one and only Veer Mahan.
Bert Hansen. Bert, I must ask, we've seen several of Veer's opponents have to receive immediate medical attention. Why would you sign up for this matchup?
Let me first note that this I was a lot smaller than daylight out of me. Okay.
But I signed up for this match because for all my life,
put my line on looking real crisp. And shout out to me.
For Monday Night Raw in my hometown of Greensboro.
He's Indian, Pakistani.
For years, way I walked down the street at Steamy's Barbecue, dreaming of this moment right here. And tonight,
I don't even know where Steamy's is at.
Come true.
I was about to ask, did you work at Steamy's?
I didn't even know where Steamy's Barbecue is right down the street.
I should have went there and be like, hey, it's me, Bert.
And
I was very excited and didn't realize how quick his hands were. That hurt. That hurt too. That hurt three. That one hurt as well. But I recover. I recover. And watch this. Watch this. Boom! Take that, brother. But he ate that. He ate that. He ate that. He ate that. And that hurt. Now at this point is where, okay, the video cut. I was kicking his ass for a good minute before this. Okay, the you know how to do the editing and stuff. I was kicking his ass, and then I slipped and fell, and then that's how he took that over. Okay.
Oh, so they did it. My whole offense is completely out.
In the locker room, it's gone. I can't even get footage. Like, I can't even get pair footage of it.
I think it's time to get back to the grill
there, young man. Just a little bit. Just a little bit. You know. Indian man can't jump. You know. With the milk. Now, at this point, I got up and I was like, come on. But then, again, the editing.
Sounds like pulled pork is
the
your
editing
future,
cut
sir.
That part out.
Veer Mahan, it's just a matter of time. Stalking his prey.
Now at this point right here, I'm realizing that I should have went and got my cookies and milk before this. And this is, listen, you live to fight another day, right? You live to fight another day. So the moment he locked that in, it was like either he can take my head and my arm, or I can take it home with me. I decided to take it home with me. I saved myself, okay? And I would not be sitting here talking to you guys had I not tapped out immediately, okay? I was being smart about that, okay? Pop said, we live to fight another day. And that's what I did, okay? That's my story.
Ain't nobody talking about your survival tactics, man. You got your ass whooped. You win some, you lose some. But you win. You lose fighting that day. All right.
So what happened right after, like, after the match is over? And you get backstage, what happens as soon as you get backstage?
So as soon as we walk backstage, Vince and everybody is sitting right there in Gorilla. And there is a point, Brian, if you can go back to the video real quick, go to the point where he's doing the knees to the gut, to the abdomen type thing.
Oh, he kicked in your gut. Let me see if I can.
Bert Hansen. Bert, I must ask, we've seen several of Veer's opponents have
to
receive
to
immediate
forward.
Medical attention. Why would
you? But anyway, explain.
So there's a point where he's doing the knees, the Valvina spot, and he was supposed to shoot me off towards the hard cam so he can do that big splash that he does, the Vader splash facing the hard cam. He got confused and sent me the wrong way. And so that's why we ended up doing it twice, and I got him back on track. When we got to the back, they were looking at me like, the hell were you, what were you doing? And then Veer actually came to the back and said, listen, I got lost, and he got me back on track. I screwed up, and he helped me, he fixed it. So he's actually talked to me. No one ever talks to me when I'm in the ring and helped me, make things look like it makes sense, made me look vicious. So if you guys want to be upset with anybody, be upset with me, because I screwed up and he fixed it. And they were all like, okay, we appreciate that, blah, blah, blah. Vince gave me a good head nod. That was it. he don't really talk much, but Shane Helms and Adam Pearce was very appreciative. They came and it was like, yo, you did a really great job. And I was actually booked for something else. Later on, I think I was booked for SmackDown as well. But because that spot was done so well, they had nothing that I could do after that, which is crazy to me because you're supposed to be creative. You're supposed to be creative writers. Why can't you write something? But after that, man, me and Veer, we sat in the back and we just talked about, we actually had some cookies and milk and catering because we both like milk. we both love milk. So we went to catering and sat and had some cookies and milk and just talked about the match and chopped it up and just changed Instagrams.
That is the least manliest thing that I have ever heard.
Hey,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, he whooped my ass.
Still,
man,
I still kick daddy's asses, brother. I still kick daddy's asses. I've been told in person that they would not want to come across me in a dark alley. That was by my boss. And I was like, accurate. I don't know why, but accurate. Okay.
Well, I can see that. Oh, man. So, yeah. Yeah, that was a throwback from the past, man. Great match from Mr. Everything. Real quick, fellas, before we go ahead and end the night, I do want to go ahead and show this clip. It's a little early, but I want Mr. Everything to go ahead and kind of talk about this Hyperdrive tournament real quick. So, Mr. Everything, if you will, sir.
Yes. So, ladies and gentlemen, starting on June 9th is going to be the Hyperdrive tournament. This is something innovative that the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast is putting together. It is going to be the beginning of something very, very big. And you guys will find out the more we have more details on it, the more we finalize some things and have some meetings and put some bells and whistles and nuts and bolts all together. But June 9th, we want you guys to be able to tune in. It's going to be fun. It's on a Sunday. It's after church. So you're not going to miss church. And you're not going to miss the tournament. We got some competitors, some of these guys you guys seen on the show, and some guys you haven't seen yet. And we're going to go out there and we're going to put on an amazing two-day tournament. June 9th, June 16th, and then the semifinals and the finals are going to happen in July. Once we start finalize those dates, we will let you guys know. But we want all of you to not only tune in, but tell everybody. Tell your cousin, your mother, your sister that was twice removed, the dog, the cat, and the goats. Tell everybody to make sure they watch the Best Damn Wrestling Championship Hyperdrive Tournament.
Yeah. I'm excited about this. You know why I'm so very excited about this? Because I always say, hey, when we have the big episode, I want to do something special. And fellas, I'm not sure if you're aware of this or not, but on the 5th, actually right before the 9th, that Wednesday will be our 100th episode of the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. And to celebrate that 100th episode, we are having this Hyperdrive tournament of independent wrestlers and wrestlers who have been doing it on every continent to come together and to show and prove who is the best, who is the king of the indies. I'm so excited about this thing. So this is our showcase, the brainchild of Mr. Everything. So I'm so excited about this whole thing. AC Divine said he was already in the gym getting ready to whoop some asses. You know what I'm saying? I'm pretty sure Stephen Meeks is getting ready to hug somebody to death. We'll see. I'm excited about it. LP, what you think about this Hyperdrive tournament, man?
Oh yeah, man. It's pretty cool. I can't wait to see the outcome and see who takes it.
You gonna join me on commentary?
I will try to if I'm able to. I need to put my account.
I always want to understand. I'm not competing, ladies and gentlemen. I am not competing in this. I'm letting guys have their own shine. And the way that the rules are going to be, let's run down the rules real quick. Is 3 rounds, 3 minutes each. In between the rounds, they have 30 seconds of rest time. It's pinfall, submission, knockout, and if you lose in the first round, that's it. The match is done. If you throw your opponent over the top rope and a foot touch the floor, you are disqualified. You forfeit the match. If you get out the ring yourself and your foot touch the floor, you are disqualified and you forfeit the match. So we're keeping everything inside the ring. It's going to be a different dynamic. And these guys have never been in a match like this before. I can guarantee you, because this is the brainchild of mine and no one has ever done this before. So it's going to be very innovative, very dynamic. These guys have no idea what they're walking into. I haven't even told them what they're doing. The only one that knows right now is AC, because he's standing right here. But other than that, no one knows exactly what's going to happen. They don't know who they're matched up with yet, and they will all find that out the day of. And we're going to get in there and see who's the best of the best of the best under me, of course, you know, because I'm the greatest.
You know, for sure, for sure. All right, Mr. Everything, man, listen, it's been a great show. And I know we have some things to talk about, but I'm so excited. First of all, I want to thank you guys, man. We have been doing this podcast for 2 years strong every Wednesday, man. And it's been a journey. It's been exciting. It's been fun. We've had some great interviews. We've had a lot of laughs, a lot of fun times. We've grown the podcast to now we have 18 sponsors that support the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast, man. I'm seeing each of these brothers grow in their perspective fields. LP just keep on throwing out banger after banger of a show. You know what I'm saying? Chef is doing his thing, cooking in the kitchen and managing multi-million dollar kitchens up here in Phoenix, Arizona. And Mr. Everything, man, is traveling the world, putting boots to asses, man, and being an absolute stud and star. So I'm excited for our journey, man, and where we are going. But I just have to appreciate everything that we've done so far, man. So thank you guys for just being solid, being down, man, and being down to express yourselves, express your personalities, and let people know how big of a nerd and wrestling fan you really are. You know what I'm saying? It's not easy. We nerds and wrestling fans got to stick together. You know what I'm saying? And technically, we run the world out of this bitch. So I just want to appreciate y'all and salute you brothers for everything that you do. You're all family men. You're all scholars and you're all leaders in your industries, man. And I'm excited for what we are going to do in the future, especially this year. So. Thank you, guys. I appreciate that. So I'm excited for our 100th episode. I'm excited for this Hyperdrive tournament to show top talent in the area, man, for people to be able to keep their eyes on and watch. I think this thing is going to be an absolute banger. And, yeah, man, just keep on following us and seeing what we got going on. Mr. Everything, let the beautiful people know what you guys going on and where can they find you.
And you already know I got a lot going on. I'm getting ready to go into production for another action movie, Birds of Prey. If you guys go and look on YouTube, look up Street Nerds Productions. I played Bronze Tiger and Nightwing Reborn, and they're bringing my character back again for the next installment of Birds of Prey. Finishing up the Changes Coming series, which, you know, I'm changing from Victor Andrews to Roosevelt. Got a couple of different magazines that's getting ready to get released pretty soon. Still doing photo shoots and then doing the traveling, going around the world, going to Germany in June. Finalizing some details with that with some sponsors to make that happen. So Frankfurt, Germany, I'm coming to your city. So make sure you check me out. Newcastle, New England, and July 28th. I'll be there for 2 weeks, and then Montreal, Quebec, Canada, in September, at the end of September, and I'll be there for a couple of days. So, man, I'm traveling, I'm doing some things, man, some big things. And, of course, you know, the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast is putting on something really big and really strong for you guys, so make sure you tune in. And, of course, follow my TikTok while it's still alive. TikTok is still alive. They ain't killed it yet. So follow my TikTok, Roosevelt, official _ Mr. Everything, or my Instagram, Roosevelt Pro Fighter.
Absolutely. LPZ in the place to be easy. Let the beautiful people know what you got going on and where can they find you?
As always, you can find me on Instagram mainly. Spell the word out one quick, which I can be shoots with an S. Right now, you know, I'm not working on any shows just yet. Right now, I'm back on photography full time, just trying to work on some upcoming things that's going to come out soon. And, you know, I post them as they come up.
Yeah, absolutely, man. So you guys go follow LP and what he got going on. LP, where can people find replays of your photo shoots? Not your photo shoots and your fashion shows. Where can people find that?
I put everything on my Instagram, so you pretty much can get my reels, a little bit on Facebook, but everything is on Instagram.
Yeah, go to LP's Instagram, man, and see what he got going on. LP be shooting with some beautiful women. Some of the most gorgeous women in the Carolinas and the Virginias and Georgia. Man, he got a whole East Coast. You know what I'm saying? He done shot Rod Digger and all kind of people. You know what I'm saying? So follow LP and what he got going on. Absolutely great photographer, man. And if you want to follow the show, well, the only thing you have to do is go over to our Instagram at the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. You can go to our Facebook group, Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. We even got a Facebook page, the BD Wrestling Podcast. We got an X or Twitter, as it was formerly known, at Best Damn Crew. You can go over to our Twitch, the Best Damn Wrestling Podcast. We still got a TikTok, and while we are still allowed to go ahead and post stuff on there, you can go over there to Best Damn Wrestling Crew. And we even got a damn store. So go over to our damn store, get you a damn shirt. We got damn hoodies. We got all kind of knickknacks, paddywhacks, and you can even give your dog a bone. So go over to the Best Damn Wrestling Store. www.bestdamnwrestlingstore.com and get you a damn shirt. Damn it. My name is Brian Renegade. You can follow me on all platforms at Brian Renegade and see what I got going on. Fellas, absolute great show. And like I said, I'm excited for our 100th episode on June 5th. I'm excited about the Hyperdrive tournament that is happening on June the 9th, where we are showcasing talent, all the best talent in the indie scene in wrestling, period. All of these men are very talented individuals, and they're going to put on the contest like you have never seen before. So I advise you to go and watch the Hyperdrive tournament on June the 9th. You will thoroughly enjoy yourself. Your boy Brian Renegade, the one and only me. Here we go. Me. I will be on commentary along with some special guest commentary, and we're going to turn the thing out. It's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. So I'm excited to see that. Fellas, real quick, let me get a final word. Let me go. LP, do you have a final word for your beautiful people?
I guess I say, if you got a dream, wake up and make it happen.
If you got a dream, wake up, get up, and make it happen. Can't nobody live your dream but you. That dream came to you. So now it's your duty to make that dream happen, or else you're going to be in mental torment for the rest of your life until it does happen. So make your dreams happen. Because can't nobody make your dreams happen but you. Mr. Everything, do you have a final word for your beautiful subjects?
Absolutely. The term sky's the limit is invalid. The sky is not the limit. If they keep claiming that there were astronauts in space, then the sky is not the limit. So exceed your limitations, excel beyond what you could have ever thought would be possible. Do not settle for no glass ceiling. Break through that. One of the coolest things, or one of the things that I remember from back in the past, is a lot of times we let fear stop us from getting to where we want to be, reaching our true potential and then reaching our true goals. And one of the things that always stuck in the back of my mind is from an episode of A Different World, when Dwayne Wayne was talking to the two boys, and they kept saying how they will never be no more than what they are because of where they came from. And he told them the story about the bug that was inside of a jar and wanted to get out the jar, and it kept flying up, and every time it would hit his head. on the jaw lid. And he kept trying and kept trying and kept trying and kept, and then would hit his head every time. And then the guy walked up and he took the jaw lid off the jar. And then the fly went to go fly up and he stopped right where the lid would be because he was feared that he would hit his head. So sometimes you got to realize that the lid is no longer there. Fly beyond your limits. That's my final word for the best damn wrestling nation.
Oh, man, that is a final word from the one and only Mr. Everything. You know what, fellas? I guess I'm going to have to echo what you guys were saying, man. Fear is the biggest dream killer. You have to fear a failure, which paralyzes you from getting started. And then you have the fear of success that slows down your momentum. And then you just have fear of yourself. And if you can actually do something that is greater than you or that nobody has ever seen being done before, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes other people put limitations on ourselves and we believe them. You know what I'm saying? If you put a dog in a cage and he stays in that cage, even if you take the cage away, he'll still feel like he's caged. It still feels like there's limits on him. He still is thinking about the parameters of his cage and still feeling like that, even if he's in freedom. You know what I'm saying? So don't put limitations on yourself. Do it despite of the fear. You know what I'm saying? Whether you fail or you succeed, as long as you are doing something and you're moving and you're active, that's the thing that matters. Because during that movement, during that journey that you're taking, you'll learn things about yourself and you'll learn things that affected you at one point no longer have power over you because you've improved and you've searched for the answers and you've search for solutions to your problems. You know what I'm saying? So don't let fear limit you from doing something that you were called to do. If you have a vision or a dream that came to you, do it. Despite of what other people may think, despite of what the limitations that you put on yourself, despite of the parameters that other people have put on you, just do it anyway. You never know how far you'll go until you stop moving. That is a final word from your boy, Brian Renegade. Oh, man. Woo. Fellas. Man, we had a great show. We got some big stuff coming. LP, I'm going to let you close us out.
All right, make sure you guys tune in next Wednesday for all we talk about wrestling, nerd stuff, music, and everything else on the next Best Damn Wrestling Podcast.
Damn right.